This is Life Center Around the Table with your host, Paul Martini.
Welcome to Around the Table podcast at Life Center. I'm your host, Paul Martini. I'm so stoked about today's podcast. We have one of the people I respect so much in our worship community, in the church today, and the anointing and grace on her life. And she's an amazing person on top of that. Stephanie Gretzinger is going to be with us in just a moment. For those of you who don't know Stephanie Gretzinger, I don't know where you've been the past, 8 years, 7 years. I know she's been doing this a lot longer, but she's really done amazing worship songs and worship leading. It's just been so fun to watch her, you know, anointing grow, and actually just her music and her worship just is so presence driven, and I just love it. Here's a clip of her latest album, and it's called Forever Amen. It came out March 2020. If you haven't downloaded that, if you haven't listened to that, go Google it, go on your Apple Music, check it out. Wonderful worship album. I love all her music. My wife and I play it all the time. In addition to leading worship, I've watched her speaking and just see how her heart is just so much for the Lord and for the church. And man, it just impresses me so much. What she is carrying is what we need today. This is her just speaking last month at a Jesus Image. I believe it was a Sunday night service. It's just so good. Here's just a 2-minute clip.
You can learn to crave Jesus. He is more satisfying than Michael and Jess ever laying hands on you. And I love them. They've changed my life. Jesus in them is changing my life all the time. But that all burns up. And that's a lonely road. It will not satisfy you. Someone in this room seeing what's on your life, acknowledging it from a pulpit, that will never, ever satisfy you. You will chase it your whole life and be frustrated that nothing comes to pass that you hoped would. And you'll be bitter and you'll walk away. And it'll be no fault but your own. Because you've taught yourself to want that's the sign that God has laid his hand on you. We've craved their opinions more than we've craved what the Lord has said about us. If you're reading more books about what other people say about Jesus than this, it doesn't count. It doesn't count for you. All those books will burn up in the fire. You can't DIY this. You can't Google your life. You can't. This is your life. Communion with Jesus is your life. It's your life. He is life. All other ground is sinking sand. All of it. All of it.
That is so inspiring, man. Just makes me want more of Jesus. Just even listening to that, man, I wish I was there that night. But you can Google that clip and just listen to the rest of that service. It's so powerful. Without further ado, I'm going to bring Steph on and just talk to her. And I just hope this podcast will bless you guys. I hope that it'll draw you closer to Jesus as you watch, and I hope that it inspires you. So, without further ado, Stephanie Gretzinger, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
You are. First of all, we at Life Center love you so much. And we love the gifting on your life, and Life Center Worship, I know, really enjoys you. I don't know if you know David Leach,
but yes.
I think they've done a couple. Yeah, he's awesome. And so yeah. we just love what you've been doing in and through the church and how you've grown. You know, it must have been 11 years now, maybe 12 years ago.
Yeah.
I went to Global School Supernatural Ministry.
Yeah.
And the first day I sit next to this girl, she seemed, you know, kind of nice. Not actually, she kind of shrugged me off for a while. And then I think she spilled coffee on me that same. And so it was like, you know, and then I'm talking to her, and she, we became good friends. Her name's Beck Burlinson, or mm-hmm. Becky Burlinson. Mm-hmm. And, as we became friends, she said, "Oh, you should meet my friend, Stephanie. She'll be in town. I think I was speaking in Ohio or something." And she came out, and I was like, "Oh, cool." And so that's where we met.
Yes.
And Rebecca is how I knew her, because right. I don't know if she told you, she tried to change her persona. And yes. So I said, "What's your name?" And she's like, "Rebecca." I was like, "Does anyone call you Becky, Beck, you know, mm-hmm. Becca?" She goes, "Nope, just Rebecca." And long story short, I go see her family, like we're hanging out, and everyone calls her Becky.
Yeah.
And I don't. Yep. So anyway, she gave up on that. I felt so betrayed, right?
I knew a different person. You know, she wanted the new thing.
Oh. But it was so cool. She was kind of explaining that I think you might have gone to Bethel a year before her, but yes. You guys were really good friends growing up.
So close.
You're from the same hometown.
Mm-hmm.
And you ended up going to BSSM.
Yes.
And she ended up going to GSSM.
Right. Right. Yeah.
I just think that's so cool. You guys kind of split the coasts.
Yes.
And
her family's so tight knit, right? Like they all live in within a few miles of each other. So
it's a community.
Her staying closer to home made sense. Yeah. It's a community. Yeah.
And almost cultish, and everyone's her cousin. So it's amazing. So I hope they're listening to this.
Yes.
But I love them. I love her parents. They're so sweet, and her brother.
Oh, so sweet.
Enough about that. Everyone sees where you're at now and just sees the gifting and calling on your life and how much you're so used in within the church. And I use that word like big C, you know, there's people who are playing your music, who are Catholics, who are Methodists, who are Lutheran, who are Pentecostal, charismatic, Baptist, even they might fast forward the tongues, but you know, like and you started a movement of not wearing shoes on stage while leading worship, whether you like it or not. I see people doing it all the time. I'm like, oh, that's the Steph Gretzinger influence, you know?
So funny. Yeah.
But so that's where people see you now. But I just think it'd be so cool to hear your story and your journey. Where were you born? Where were you raised? How did you get involved with all this Jesus stuff?
Yeah. My dad and mom have been in ministry my whole life. I was born in Oskaloosa, Iowa, into a little Nazarene church. I grew up Nazarene / Wesleyan. They're similar, but they are not the same, you know, for anyone listening. You know, they were in music ministry. My parents were, my mom's a brilliant musician. She just is, singer-songwriter. We lived in Nashville for a while. Dad always did music too, but was always a pastor. He was the youth pastor, the discipleship pastor. He one of those that kind of does everything that's needed. He was one of those guys. And then, as I got older, we started having, you know, people manifest demons, and he became the deliverance pastor. He's like, "Lord, show me how to set the captives free or get me out of the ministry. I don't want to do this. I don't want to see people come back to the altar bound and more so than they were the last time they came. This is, you didn't die for this." And so, you know, that's how we found ourselves in, like, ironically, in a worship and deliverance ministry, which makes a lot of sense together now. But, you know, at the time it was interesting. It kind of felt like we were our whole family, almost like this Davidic thing where, you know, we're going to go play for Saul, he's being tormented, you know, like, it started that way. And I have lots of memories of them, us being with friends, and you go from laughing and playing and it always ending up in, you know, worship and prayer around a piano or an instrument. And, so I think I had it easy in this way that, my parents made it very easy for me to fall in love with Jesus. They were the real deal. And the longer that I live, I realize how rare it was that that was the case. And
I mean, even though you grew up in that setting, it didn't seem like, from what you're telling me, was it like religious?
Was there
legalism?
There was very much, the word is a beautiful, what I loved about the church I grew up in, man, they love the word of God. The articles of faith were beautiful. But there was not in those churches internationally, but in the States, a lot of resistance to the movement of the Spirit. My dad would always, he just would read the word and go, there's more. There has to be more. And I think at home we'd like pray for that more. And then in his office, that would happen a lot. You know how it kind of happens.
Yeah.
But a lot of religion, a lot of rules, without, you know, meaning to.
What kept you? Well, I have a lot of friends who have a similar experience, right? You know,
right.
Who grow up in a Christian environment, Christian home.
Right.
And what saved you from being hurt or offended by a religious, you know, from all the sheep fighting each other? saved you from that?
Well, I mean, Jesus did. The kindness of Jesus is that in the middle of whatever you're in the middle of, if he's the way, the truth, and the life, and if you're looking for him, you'll find him. I'm still shedding things that are from that time, you know, like the need to get it right, or do those different pressures you feel that are unspoken, right?
Yeah.
But he saved me. I encountered a real Jesus because I asked for him. I'm like, I know that. Mm. I think my parents taught me enough to say, hey, we're still human beings, and we are trying to teach you something that we're still trying to figure out.
Wow.
And I think humility goes a long way. So while they, you know, would be the first to tell you that they, you know, made mistakes and that they were trying to shake their religion, there was also this, I think good lovers are good learners, and they were always learners, you know, like they were always students. And I think that it covered, you know, love covers a multitude of sins. I mean, all the things that we, in our broken, bad theology, because we all have it, you know, we saw a real Jesus, and he was like pushing through it. And I just have felt, it takes time to shed all those things, but that saved me. An encounter with his presence. I asked for it. I'll never forget being in my room, which was like, I think I had bunk beds at the time. And I think I was in middle school, and I had believed in the Lord for a long time. But I remember the day I said to him, I know you're the God of my father and my mother and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And I know, I believe all these things are true. I believe it all happened, but I need to know that if I called on your name, that you would answer me, that you will be my God, and that you would respond to me because I am seeking you, not just because my father sought you, even though that is the gift of from generation to generation, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm telling you what, and he met me, I'll never forget. He met me like a mist filled my room and a rainbow, and you couldn't make it up because there was nothing. It's like there was nothing going on. I'd been laying there in my bed praying, and I'm looking around. It just was like appeared over me. It was almost like he came and said, I promise I will. I'm when you call it, I'm coming. And you know, it never happened again. But I knew that he had met with me, and you know, I really did seek him with all my heart. I sought him with everything I knew how, and he sees that. You know, whether we do it really poorly, it's really clunky, he's so kind. He sees the position of our hearts, and so I mean, he saved me. I encountered a real Jesus, and it'll take
all of eternity. I mean, like, there's no end. It'll take always and forever to know him. He's endless, you know? So
yeah.
You never arrive.
You just keep going. I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, you never arrive. No, interrupt me anytime and questions or stop me if you're ready to move on. Like, I just keep going. I have a wild sort of, we grew up in the, like, I kiss dating goodbye situation and, like, really, really rigid, like, you don't touch or hold hands or anything. Like, it was just like, and there's only one. Yes. There's only one. And if you miss this, you're screwed. Like, there's no coming back.
A lot of pressure.
Yeah, it's a lot of pressure. And so, like, and of course, this is without every detail, you know, but because it's a really cool story. But I mean, I was engaged to two people before I met my husband in Reading and married him. Like, by the time I had been to Reading, I had been engaged twice. Because you told me
one time that Will Hart ruined one of those for you.
Sure did. Love him. So love him.
I remember that when we were talking, you know, I don't know how many years ago.
We had revival. We had the wildest. And Randy came. Uh-huh. And then Will came. And Jamie came. Like, I mean, the Lord just did a wild thing. But we had, the Lord broke out in our little Nazarene church in Worcester, Ohio. And I'm telling you, we were never the same again. Never the same again. I have never been the same again. But I had prayed for the Lord to move, for him to show himself to us, like, my whole life, the best I knew how. And so had my, you know, dad. And we were just, like, overwhelmed. You know, we didn't bring those guys out. They flew themselves out. It was the wildest thing. Like, half of us didn't know him. I think they knew Jerry. Like, none of us knew who they were. They just came. And yes, one night I was engaged to the pastor's son, who I'm still wonderful friends with, by the way. We're dear friends, and every chance we get to worship together, we still do. So I say this with so much honor and gratitude for the healing of the Lord. But we were engaged in the middle of one of those services. I will never forget it as long as I live. Will comes up to me, and we were just worshiping. I think it was a ministry time. He walks up to me while I'm on a mic, which wasn't the main event. Nobody else could hear this. He walks up to me and he says, he goes, uh-huh. You and your husband have bread for the nations. And he said, I fly backwards probably 10 feet. And I don't remember flying or falling. Just that I'm up, like, on the drum kit, and I'm not sure what's happening. I'm like back that far. That's only happened to me that one time too. I'm like way back. And Will is next to me, and he's like, says it again. You and your husband have bread for the nations. And he said, are you married? And I said, not yet. And he said, are you engaged? And I said, yes, I am. And he looks kind of confused, because I knew he was hearing from the Lord, but he's like, who are you engaged to? And I point to Nate, and he goes, huh, well, you and your husband have bread for the nations. And wow. I was like, okay. And I had deep inside, I was like, I know that this is not, I'm meant to go, and you're feel meant to stay. And this isn't gonna work, you know? And it didn't. And I'm telling you, I went and I met that one. But it's just a wild story. Like, God, he really, really takes when you have a heart of obedience, when you really, really want to obey him, you really, really want to do it his way. He gets you there. I don't even know how to, right? Like, if you keep yielding, you find yourself in that space, even if you would have totally ruined it on your own. You know, I was like, I was going in the direction I thought that he had spoken, but then it was like, oh, this didn't happen. It didn't happen that way. And so the Lord, you know, pulled me out of the cycle of trying to, I think, please and get way under like opinions. And I call them prophetic opinions because I think that we've got a lot of that.
It's a great. Yeah, it's great.
In the church. And I, like, as someone who loves to hear the word of God and loves to share it, I just was like, oh, there's been so much mixture. There's been so much mixture. And I'm like, oh, I don't want to give people prophetic opinions where it's like a little bit, maybe the Lord was in that. And then the rest of it was like a lot of me, you know, a lot of what I think you should be doing instead of what the Lord's saying. And it's so dangerous. And I think, you know, I wanted so much to honor leaders. I wanted so much to honor the Lord that I was like, yeah, it took me a while to go, okay, I know you talk to me. I have to dethrone the opinion of man so that I can actually digest it. You know what I mean? Like I had to, like, that was hard for me. I had to go, okay, I love you. I honor you, but I cannot elevate you. I can't, I got to get you out of this seat. You got to get out of this seat. And good leaders and good mothers and fathers don't want to be in that seat anyways. They don't.
Right.
They actually want to raise a child and release them. They want to raise and release. They're not looking to, like, you know.
Control.
That's right. We need disciples, not duplicates, right?
Come on.
So I think that's what I would, like, I kept having to repent of that, like, enthroning the opinion of man, because you want them to be proud of you. You want, mm-hmm. And when you have a kind of, religion does skew your view of authority a bit, right? And it kind of gets you going on positional authority more than spiritual authority. And that can get real weird, you know, but the beauty of it is the Lord honors our hearts and he sees like the depths. He sees the depths and he knows when we are, our hearts are to obey, you know? Anyway, so
good.
Anyways.
That had to have been a tough conversation though. Talking, not only is this fiance of yours someone who, you know, you genuinely love at some level.
Yeah. Oh,
you know, I mean, he's a good friend now. And of course, you're engaged at the time. Yeah. And then it's the pastor's son. That's got to be a lot of obedience. I mean, because it's, yeah, I mean, there's so many people, you know, especially, you know, pastoring and being in the some sort of level of leadership, mm-hmm. Throughout the past few years, there's a lot of people who just went along with the marriage because it just was more convenient, or they kind of fell into it, and thank God they're being faithful to the covenant they made with that person. But, you know, so I guess what I'm saying is breaking off engagement's not easy. And so that took a lot of faith.
No, it's not. It's not at all.
What's that conversation like? If you don't mind me asking.
No, not at all. I think by the time, it was brutal. It was brutal because I was still like, you know, it's the stage of using your voice where you're like not used to hearing it that way. And like the ironic thing is, Paul, like I was scared of the stage. I was not, like, when my parents used to call me up to sing with them as a kid, a couple times I ran out of the room crying. I was terrified, like, of being in front of tons of people. I'm a miracle because this is not, I was very nervous of that. And so nervous to confront, nervous to be, you know, trusted with something that felt so big, nervous to be, you know, all the things. I was like, I'm so scared. I'm going to blow all the things. And the Lord just was relentless with me because I, you know, he knew, and I was relentless with him. I knew, I was like, I know if there's anything, any reason I'm alive, it's you. This is what I know. Even as a little girl, I knew it. But that conversation was like, it was scared. I mean, I was scared, but I did it. We did it. And I think he had a feeling too. I think he knew deep down we were like, yeah, this is what's happening. I love you. I mean, a bird might love a fish, but where would they live? It was a little bit like that, you know? And, but we just, it was really painful, but the Lord, worked it all out.
The Lord opened a door for you to go to BSSM and you're like, see ya.
Bye.
Was it like that? Was it like that?
It was still a bit after that. You know what's wild? I moved to Columbus. I moved back to Columbus for like 9 months, just to get away, because that's big. And I wanted to give them time to heal, me time to heal. And I went and lived with this crazy prophet, and I love her so much, and her family out in the country, close to Becky K, actually, like way out there. And she, like, it was so wild how accurate. I didn't have time for all the stories, but she was wild. And every day she'd like burst into the room and go, do you want to pray? And I'm like, yes, 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 I do, my people. So she was the most wonderful, wonderful person. She was like my dad's right hand in deliverance ministry. I mean, like, they were so dear to our family, and I got to live with them. So the morning after I moved there, I was like sobbing, Paul. I was like, this is a big, you feel embarrassed. You feel ashamed. You feel like, how could I not have seen this coming? Why did I get into this in the first place? And why could I not have just, you know, trusted, you know, my dad's the only one who warned me. My dad warned me, and I was like, but dad, I think it's, listen. I went down, they have a library in this house. I went downstairs and I had no idea. I just was like, so my heart just felt broken. And did I do the right thing? Did I just change the course of my life? Like, Lord, I just want to obey you. And I was drawn to Heidi's book. And I didn't really, really know. I didn't really know Heidi at that point. I just knew of her. But is it called There's Always Enough? I think it was like the first one she wrote, isn't it? Anyways, I pulled one of her books out of the whole wall. I mean, like a whole wall of books. I see this one and I'm like, oh, I got to read this book. And it's like 4 or 5 a.m. or something. I open it and I go to literally, I open it literally to the part of the book where she breaks off her engagement with the first guy.
Wow.
It was too cool. I mean, like, you can't make that stuff up. He's just so faithful.
So
I mean, and there's a long time to spend on that. I don't know. Maybe it's important. Maybe it's not. But those were the kind of things that I had to work through, you know, all the prophetic opinions.
Yeah.
And really.
And that fear of man. I mean, that's
fear of man.
Like, what dethroned it for you? Like, I know you said you've identified it. And you know, because a lot of people know they struggle with that. I mean, I do in some respect.
Sure, because it matters to us. It just can't be enthroned, right?
Right. So how did you dethrone it? Was it just more time with Jesus? You cared more about his thoughts than man's thoughts, and that finally won out?
Or were I, like I, an I tried experience? That for a while, but then I realized I needed to repent. I think
so good.
I was, you know, because you're afraid of punishment, and the deal is like, I didn't have language for that yet. When I went to Reading, I was really thankful. I got a lot of language for what was already, you know, stirring in there. That's the brilliance of good teachers, you know, that like have a mantle. You're like, oh, that is what I haven't known how to say. And, but I remember once I was getting language for it, I just, the Lord in these last, I mean, fast forward, even in the last several years, is like, hey, even this year, especially, it's like fear is like the most tolerated sin in the church. How many times does he say, fear not? And I was so afraid of them punishing me or being bad, being like them thinking that I didn't love the Lord because I did this differently or because I was expressive in worship, because I started speaking in tongues on the microphone in a Nazarene church, and that was not okay that day. I'm telling you, but it flew out of my mouth. I wasn't practicing it. I wasn't asking for it. It flew out of my mouth. And you know, like, and I honored them. I pulled off the mic. I totally honored them. But I just, there was something going on. And I thought, this is, you're doing a work in me. And I just asked for you. I didn't ask for the manifestations. I didn't ask for any of the other stuff. I asked for you. So I need you to show me what to do with this and where to go with this, because I won't stop the move of God inside of me. But I do need to be in a place where you can do that. You know, you can continue. And my pastor and I had a wonderful talk. He so blessed me to go. And when I realized that I was actually sinning by enthroning them. It was actually a sin. It wasn't just like, oh, it's all right, sweetheart. You're just afraid. You've had a bad experience. Like, you can only counsel that so much. It's just sin. It's just sin. And so when I repented of that and I asked the Lord, like when we repent, we return, right? So it's like we repent, we remember, and we return. It's what happens when we worship too, because he's the main event again, and there's not mixture. And when there's no mixture, it's a pure line. It's a pure line. It's a clear connection. And it's like, oh, we repent, we remember, we return. And so it was very, very like helpful for me to remember, like, if I didn't deal with that thing, it was going to keep happening. If I didn't repent, then it wasn't going to change. I couldn't just go, don't think that, don't think that, don't think that, don't think that. You know what I'm saying? Because if it's sin, it has to be repented. We have to repent for it. You can't just like, I'm gonna sit and think new thoughts until I don't believe the old ones anymore. I'm all about that. I'm all about thoughts and the science of it, because I think that's the way the Lord made us. But you can't, when there is a root of sin, you cannot like pat somebody on the back until it goes away. That's not how it works. Right. So I really had to call that what it is. I was being too kind with something that was actually needed to be cut out. And it was so really good. Beautiful, because God is kind. Like, religion wasn't kind, and I was afraid of punishment, but he was going, hey, just repent. Just repent. It restores the standard. And then we start over. And I'll show you, like, then you're gonna hear my voice, and that'll be out here. Right? When we deal with the root, it's not coming up in us. And then we can recognize when it's coming at us. Right? That's a different deal.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's different. Right. It will still come here sometimes, but it doesn't live here.
Right.
And so that shifted that. Because that's an ongoing journey, because everybody has opinions about your life. As a leader, like, it would be crushing if I had continued that pattern forever.
Yeah. You know? That's great. And I know it's going to minister to so many people, you explaining that process and identifying, and it's so beautiful. And then, you know, you end up in Reading. What was your expectations at Reading? Were you going just to get, I mean, most of the time it's like, I just want to go because God called me here and I want more of God. I'm trying to like remember the scene back then, because it would have been 2008, something like that.
Uh-huh.
And so I'm thinking Kim Walker Smith was still there.
Yep.
She's probably leading worship with Jen Johnson and Brian Johnson. And I don't remember, maybe Chris Kalila came in a little bit after that.
Yeah.
So,
he was still there.
I mean, that's the scene, right? With the worship scene. And then it's just really Chris, Danny, and some of the pastors and Bill speaking into your guys' lives with some guest speakers. But so that's kind of the scene. What was that process like for you? What was your expectations of the school?
Yeah, I was a part of the class that, I forget who, I think Bob Jones prophesied about the 1,000 Eagles. So we were part of that when it hit.
What is that? Most people won't understand.
I don't remember the whole thing. I'd have to go back. I need it. I would love to go back and listen to it, but he had the Lord gave him a vision of, I think, a number of different places that were, he said, were eagles' nests, different cities and different places. And that we were one of the eagles' nests, and that it was that year. It was, he said something about when the school reached 1,000 or something. Yeah, it was that's how I remembered it. But powerful word. I would love to go back and listen to it. But, you know, I don't know if I had, I was so hungry, Paul. I was so hungry for more of the Lord. I don't think I don't know if I would have cared. I think anything would have been wonderful to me. I didn't come in going, bless me if you can, let's see what you've got. I was hungry. I mean, the first day of school, I wept. I ugly cried uncontrollably. I mean, I remember Bill speaking, and I am on the ground wailing. I run to the front wailing, and I'm like dealing with a bit of embarrassment because it's uncontrollable at this point. And I'm like, I'm that girl right now. I am like, I cannot contain my affection for the Lord, my hunger. And I'm also don't know if this is the time. I don't know. But as he was speaking and I'm wailing on the floor. Wow. And I just was like, I felt so much gratitude. I just felt so much gratitude to be in a place where you, I was surrounded by people who'd come for the same reason, you know, who were here to burn. Oh, I just wanted to burn. I wanted to burn. And I was never the same. It was just the most, I had a wonderful journey. You know, everybody has different experiences. I felt like I was right in the center of in the revival group I was meant to be in with the mm-hmm. revival group pastor I was meant to be in. I just felt like the Lord walked me through that. I'll never forget one time, you know, he, even in first year, just as an example of some of the things that I think worked through. I remember one day he so saw us. It was really beautiful. And we were doing a fire tunnel. And one day he came and tapped me on the shoulder and he said, hey, I want you to go through the fire tunnel. And I remember fear of man at first is doing that creep up thing. Like, he thinks that something's wrong. He thinks that you've failed and he sees something. So I, you know, I'm like, oh my goodness, what did I do? What am I in trouble? It was like that. Mm-hmm. And I went and I walked through I did exactly what he said to. I walked back and I'm sitting literally in the back of the room and I'm just streaming tears. And he comes and sits next to me. This is so sweet. He comes and sits next to me and he says, Stephanie, he said, I didn't send you through as a punishment. He said, I sent you through that fire tunnel because you seem tired today. And he said, Steph, he said, what you are carrying, he said, it's important for us, but it's important for the world. And I need you to learn how to take care of yourself. I need you to learn when it's a day to go through instead of being the one ministering. And it changed my life. It changed my life. And it was breaking off all the things that I felt were expected of me by people and letting me just really, really respond to the Lord. You know? Wow. So helpful for me. And that was the biggest thing for me. That, you know, in first year and then in second year, man, the Lord, that's when I feel like in worship, I didn't even want to go and lead worship. I had no desire to be a worship leader, Paul. I didn't know I was going to do that.
How'd you get involved with it? Did they just hear you worshiping? You were standing next to somebody and they're like, man, that girl's got a good voice. Why don't we put her up there? Like, how did that happen?
You know, what's funny is they did tryouts for first year and I did not want to do them, but I feel like somebody
called you out.
It was, yeah, somebody did. And they're like, you know, this isn't like, this is for school. Like you're carrying something for our class. Like you need to just do it. Like there's like 100 people on stage. It's like you're in a line and they're running you through and they're like, okay, sing 30 seconds of this. And then they move you like you're out. It's like cattle, man. You're just like, well, all right. All right. But, which is just such a weird feeling, but it's just the way it was. And, man, the Lord, it was true. It was true. Like there were, our class was full. And I mean, full of like high level leaders, our whole class. Wow. I mean, like throw a coin. You'll hit one. I mean, it was like, it was crazy.
Was JP in your class?
No, he was not. He was the year after us.
Okay. Do you know we went to the same high school?
What?
Yeah.
I don't know if I remember that in Philly.
Yeah, I met him a couple times, and then we started talking like the third time we met, and I was like, wait, what high school did you go to? And he's like, Neshaminy High School. I was like, that was my high school. We were in the same building, probably in the same, like, I think we probably maybe were a year or two in the same, because he's a little bit younger than me, like two, 3 years younger.
Yeah.
So pretty crazy. But anyway, you're right. There was a lot of amazing leaders that year.
Yeah. So many. Anyways. Yeah. And seriously, stop me anytime, because there's way too many details, and I'm like, well, they're way too, it's like memory lane for me. And it's like, wow, it's all.
That's okay. I just want to. Yeah. No, that's awesome. I just want to kind of like say, you know, like, how did this unfold for you? Obviously this worship. You know, obviously you were leading worship at the church when you left, you know, you're going to Bethel School for more of Jesus. I guess that's, you know, that's a good summary. And then they hear you sing and they're like, hey, I think you could do this. And then you start leading worship.
Yeah. I'm plugging you in.
This is awesome.
Super classy.
Love that ceiling. It's a great painting.
It's super good. Yeah. I mean, I think it just, I remember singing in first year, and it was just one of our normal class sets, and the room was dark. We were just in sound check, and I think Jen Johnson came through. She was standing in the sound booth and was like, who's that? And this is not how they do it. It's not the norm. That only happened, I think, a couple times. That's not normal at all. There's a whole like thing you go through, but they, and beautifully so, but she said, who's that? I want her on my team. I need to find out who that is. And I think the next Sunday I was singing background vocals for them. And, you know, and she would say this too, like that it was really rare. And I thought to myself, I mean, they can trust me, but I don't think they should, you know, like this is crazy. Like I wouldn't do that if I were them, but I know that they, cause I was happy to be in the background, but I also was like, I also knew that I wasn't after the stage. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
Yeah. I had no interest in that. And, I was very happy to be in the back of the room. Very, very happy to be in the back of the room.
Was there people in your life, like in the worship community, that were more, you know, supportive and mentors that kind of like put you to,
you know,
one step over the other? Or was it just like a faithful, you know, a lot of it was inclinations from the Holy mm-hmm. Spirit. And you're like, you know what, I need to write a song, or, you know, I need to publish. I need to, you know what I mean? What was it more of?
I would say I had input on that, because I wouldn't have done anything with those things if I was left on my own. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, back in the day, I mean, like William would like say, hey, he would like in the middle of something, he's like, hey, you've got something. And he would stand there until I sang. Like, but it was true. I mean, I did have something. And, and Jeremy, oh goodness, Jeremy, like he shared his big wings with me, you know, until I grew mine. He was really, really covering. I mean, like, that was such a beautiful journey. Such a beautiful season of like, I'll never forget one time, you know, being on the road, and Jeremy goes, I think Stephanie, cause I was very, very comfortable. I would just like lay on the floor. If I didn't feel like I had anything, or if we were in a moment, I just had no, like, I'm just going to, not anything. I have no need to sing it out and keep it to me and the Lord. It's not a thing. And Jeremy stopped the entire band and everything and just goes, I feel like the Lord has given Stephanie a word. And he just looks at me. I'm on the floor in a ball. And he goes, I feel like the Lord's given Stephanie a word. We'll just all just wait. Talk about like the most uncomfortable silence. I was so mad at him. I was amazing. I was like, no. But sure enough, man, sure enough, I did. I was carrying something. So I think I was building bravery, and the Lord, it's like he lent me his wings, you know, and he would cover like,
so good.
I'd step out and he'd cover it. And then, you know, the more I yielded until I, years later would become a covering. You know what I mean? It was so wonderful. I don't know what I would have done without them. Yeah, and I wouldn't have shared my songs either if, you know, like Amanda and, you know, people like that hadn't said, people need to hear this. I'm like, I don't know if they do. I don't know if they do. And she's like, that's really nice of you, but this is not just for you. And so, yeah, I mean, we all helped each other, right? Like we needed each other.
And, were you a technical person? Like, were you, you know, did you study music? Did you, did everyone have to bring you up to speed where they're like, you know, or were you like, yeah, that's C, that's D, that's A flat, or was other people around you going, actually, it's a little higher, you know, like,
yeah,
you know,
no, what, I had really,
reading
really
music,
good,
all that.
Yeah. No, that's a really good question. I did play piano when I was little. I could follow music a bit, but I didn't stick with it. My mom was brilliant at that. So was my dad. I think I didn't, when I was younger, I think they were so good at it. I just would sing along. I had an excellent ear, like for parts and for, like I could, if someone was singing a part that didn't go with the chord being played, I could really clearly hear that.
You could
tell. Like, so, and I had really good relative pitch, but I couldn't tell you what, I could find it. Like if I had sung something out, I could go find it, or I could find the root note, or I could find the one. Once I learned, like somebody had to teach me numbers so that I could find a way to communicate what I was hearing. Until then, I would just sing it. I was like, I'm looking for it. I would tell them what I was looking for, or, I mean, I had to learn to be a good leader. I was dripping with oil, but I didn't know how to lead people. And that took time. Like, I mean, I'll never forget Gabe Valenzuela saying to me, this is great. We know you can, you know, we know you can blow up a room, but can you lead them? Can you lead them? Like, and I'm like, wow, you know, it was really helpful to me that he said that. And because I had been dealing with the fear of man stuff, I was like, I felt the love in that. I was like, oh yes, this, I can rise to that. This is about the Lord. It's not about me. I want to grow. I want to learn. So yeah, I let our,
and because you didn't have the fear of man, you didn't interpret that comment as a criticism. It was a call for higher.
That's right. It was an opportunity to rise. It's like,
so
the,
good.
It is the kindness of comparison. It's not the, you know, the chaos. I do get concerned that we pray away comparison all too often because we think it's all from the devil. And sometimes I do believe the Lord puts us next to people who are bigger than us so that we can rise. And if we're constantly praying away all of that process, then we will miss we'll miss the rising. And, you know, I just,
the call for more. Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, that's,
yeah.
So it's like, so you did the, I'll let you finish. Cause I want
to, I don't have anything else to say. I'd rather you kind of lead me through it. So I say,
cause you're doing great. You're doing great. So that comment call to, you know, you can blow up a room, but can you lead them?
Yeah.
What would you describe as, if you can articulate it? Cause I know sometimes it's hard to articulate something like this, but what would you describe the difference between, you know, worshiping in a room and leading people into worship?
Well, you know, this is what's coming to mind. Tell me if this is helpful. And if not, I can say it another way, but I feel like I'm coming back to the place, and I'll bring it around. In the last years, I'm not making much of, I think we got into a space where we'd glorify the prophetic gift, or we'd glorify this one, and pastoring wasn't always popular. But inside of Jesus is all of these things. He's the all sufficient, complete in himself one. He is all of these things. All of the fivefold and way, way, way beyond that are all inside of him. And if we make much of Jesus, then we have every part that we need. Now, I'm not by nature a pastor. It's not the mantle on my life. But to be like, there's a difference. There's a difference in, like, you can blow up the room. It's one thing if you, get a word. It got to be such a thing. And now I'm like, I care nothing about hearing a word for the room. I just want to see Jesus. And if he will pour himself out on me, I know that whatever flows is what the people will need anyway. And I'm learning, like, learning to value all of that just as much. It was, in a sense, it was like he was saying to me, this is great. Weigh this moment, which the room would have considered all this prophetic moment, spontaneous, blah, 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 which I think we magnified way too much. But when that would happen, he's saying, can you pastor the room into the next place in his presence? Can you now pastor them? Will you value that as much? And I took that challenge. I felt the power of that. I think, I think that, I want to answer the question. So remind me where I'm going, because.
It's all right. We're just talking about what's the difference between worshiping in a room and leading people into worship.
Right. I think that a little bit.
That kind of answers that.
Yeah. And there's a difference. The Lord said to me earlier this year, if you know, a good leader will point you in the right direction, but a mother or father, a true parent will walk you all the way home. And I realized that as a young person who was learning to lead, there was this desire to go, Jesus, look at him, like point him in the right direction. But in these years, I'm a young mother, but I am a mother. And the value, that movement from warrior to elder, that movement from like, into like, okay, but I want this to last. I want you to be burning long after I'm gone. You know, you do lead differently. You're not leading for a moment. You don't walk in as a leader or a mother and go, what is the most amazing moment that we could find here today? No. What I want when I come in is to so move the Lord's heart that he is poured out on his people, and I lead them into his presence, and then I am completely in the background after that. Like a really good leader wants to disappear. Once the Lord is in, like when the Lord is in the room, they just are like, this is the one I wanted you to meet all along. You know, this is the connection I wanted to make. Right. So I think that's the big difference. And growing in spiritual authority and not just, dripping with oil, because there is the anointing, and then what we do with it is how we grow our authority, right? Because you can be really, really oily and it's beautiful, but you do want to grow in authority so that you can lead people to another place,
right?
So I don't know if that's helpful, but that's what comes.
No, it's awesome. It's a great answer. You know, I struggled with I love Heidi. Heidi's like my favorite person. I'm like, wow, this is, you know, like you just see Jesus shining through her. It's like, I'm like, this is Mother Teresa on steroids to me sometimes, you know.
Exactly.
not to disregard anything Mother Teresa did, because she's amazing. But I just felt like I'm meeting someone who's you know, just a history maker. But when I see her, when I would watch her, and oftentimes it was like at Voice of the Apostles or one of the conferences, and, you know, everyone's just having these amazing messages, hitting it out of the park. And I know Heidi can preach. I mean, she's got her PhD. She knows the word. She can preach.
That's right.
But every time I watched her, maybe the first four or five times sitting under her ministry, she would get on her knees and she would speak in tongues for 15 minutes in front of all these pastors and leaders and 5,000 people. And she'll start, and I'm going, and in my mind, and Steph, I'm like, I've learned to preach. I've learned to, you know, like Randy personally discipled me. And I go, man, if I would have done that at any of the conferences that I've been to, pastors would be like, all right, Paul, it's time to go. Or like, you got to do something, Paul. Like they would try to get me either off the stage or, you know, and so I would watch as the room, just to my amazement, would be, what's going on to I don't know if I like this.
Yeah.
To, I'm offended. To, I mean, she won't stop. She's just praying and praying and praying. Yeah. And yeah. And then the whole time she's doing it, she's going, you can spectate or you can come. You
That's
can watch
right.
or you can come.
Yes.
You can notice who Jesus is or you can wait for him to do something. And she
That's
keeps,
it.
And I'm like, oh, wow, she's leading everyone to where
yes.
she's at.
Yes.
And she's criticizing those who choose to be offended or choose not to join or choose because they're so comfortable. I mean, like she's, and then, and it's amazing by the end of the night. I mean, she's got the majority, I would think, of everyone
yes.
just like, okay, it's not about actually her. It's about what she, and you know, like this is her life laid out. You're watching
yes.
her life laid out. And,
yes.
And then she starts to preach and tell some stories with 10 minutes left. You know,
yes, like, yes, like, yes.
And so I just, that's
and
Heidi.
All
and I,
full of wailing, laid down lovers.
Yes. Oh yeah. Yeah.
It's
yeah.
Like
and,
it,
and it's her life and her life represents yes. that. And she had spent so much time with the Lord that
that's right. That's,
you know? And so I'm like, I'm not there yet because if I would have done that, I would have been like booed off the stage, you know? I mean, I'm just being facetious,
totally.
But you know that her life reflects that, and I think what you're saying is in similar fashion. Like, you're not just there to do a performance or sing a song,
no.
but you're not just even hosting a presence, but you're encouraging people to go where Jesus is. So that's it's awesome, so beautiful.
Yes.
One of the things I love is and Steph, like, not trying to you know, increase your ego or trying to hype you up or anything like that. But I can tell how that you've been in the presence, which like when you lead worship, I just, it comes through, you know, your time with the Lord, your time in the Word and your growth. And not like saying you need it to grow or anything like that, but just, you know, you never know how much someone can grow. And then you see them and you're like, wow, they're so, and you know, this, worshiping and worship leading is awesome and that's on your life, but man, ministering like with you, like watching you at Jesus Image, Steph, you're killing
it.
I mean, this is just, it's so good. And look, I grew up, this is one thing I thought was always fun when I would listen to you. I would always know if you're in the audience sometimes at Bethel, because I grew up during the time, not I grew up, but in my ministry time or in my, you know, student
yeah.
time, people, when something resonated, especially when Bill said something, everyone
yeah.
said, so good,
so good.
Good. Or
so
come
good.
On, come on, come on.
Come
and so it's
on.
In me, you know, like
same.
I would mock the grandma who would say, you know, amen in my Pentecostal church. But now I'm doing my version of it because it was my stream of people that verified, that witnessed in my spirit that something
yes.
was said that's the Lord. So I'd be like,
that.
So good, come on. And in my mind, I'm going, man, every other person in my stream at that time frame is repeating what I'm repeating. And so I'm like, and I noticed how like we would try to decipher, like my friend Will Hart, he was tired of everyone saying so good and he saying so good. So he would be like, fantastic. You know, he would try different, he would
yes.
try different things like fabulous, terrific, you know? But one thing, but I know you say stuff like, let's go. That's you.
I didn't even know.
That is you, right? That's you in the audience,
yes,
right?
That's me. That's me.
You say, let's go. Or
let's
you say,
go.
You say like, it's cooking or something. You say like some funny stuff. And I
Well, I don't say it's cooking, but I don't think about it like.
You like stand up and point.
Now, yes, I do. It's like old church lady. All my friends are like, you, there's like a distinct shift. Like you're
yeah.
like you're like old lady status now. But I do, you hold up your Bible and you point. And I do remember saying drive the bus pastor a couple times.
That's
it
was
out.
Something like that.
Drive the bus
yeah.
pastor.
Drive
I did
the
say
bus
that.
Pastor. Is
Which
that
is
like a Ohio
to,
thing?
Nope. I have no
okay.
idea. I probably picked
I was just
it up
like,
and
I need something. Reading. I need something that's not, you know, come on and so good. But that's
yeah.
what I want to say.
Yeah, listen. It's and that I mean a couple times my dad would always say that dog will hunt. When somebody had
that
a good
dog
point,
will
that
hunt.
Dog will hunt.
Oh, I'm gonna steal that. because no one says it around here. So
I do say that sometimes. I don't usually holler that in church, but I do say that.
You say it to your neighbor.
Well, and it's such a I mean, I think sometimes I'm like, I think the rest of life is for like the communion with people. But when we gather, when we've gathered, if we're going to call it a worship service, we have come for him. Yeah. We've come to offer him something that he's worthy of. I'm actually not in the room, and I'm not in the room to have a program for all the people at this point. I'm here to go, look at the Lamb. You came in with all sorts of stuff. I'm so glad you brought it. You can leave it here. You can leave it here at his cross. Look at the Lamb. Look at Jesus, you know? Wow. And I think we've made it so much about us. I don't even know that we could call it worship half the time. It's a priesthood. It's not an industry. And it's not what the people needed when they came in. You know, God doesn't have an ego. He's like, he is worthy of it. It realigns us to worship, you know? And so I think that even that agreement is, I don't know, it feels so important. It feels like worship to me, you know, because I don't think there's any shift. Like when this starts getting preached, it's worship. Like, that's why it's been the longest time since I even told any of my story, because I just have been in a space where I'm like, yeah, that's good, but this is better. This is way better. I don't want to... So it's actually really fun to, I know we're like probably way over, but it's been sweet to relive some of those moments with you, because it's the testimony of Jesus setting us free and getting over ourselves and making it about him.
Yeah.
You know, because he's so worthy, and he's like, well, I love what you said about Heidi. You know, she was part of like the Lord used her to help set me free. Like, no, this is what you burn for, and it's okay. Like, it's okay for half the room to leave if they don't want. Like, I'm not moving unless you do. That's where I want to live, you know? Like, until the Lord falls, I'm not doing anything.
She just doesn't care.
She does not care.
I'm
thankful. I'm so thankful the Lord has delivered me of that. It changes
everything.
She's
beyond. She has so much trust in the Lord about everything. And I know... Like, I know we think we do, and then you meet someone like Heidi, and you're like, I need to reassess. I need to repent.
I was in
Australia with her, and it was her event. It was to raise money for missions and for her organization. And they live like hand to mouth on purpose. You know, everything they get, they give away. You know, Will's like, we don't keep money. We don't do it because it's too much. The need's too great.
Right.
And so we're the Lord's moving so awesome in worship to praying for her missionaries, because they also come as like a refreshing time to prophesying over them, and they miss the offering. And I'm like, Will, you got to take an offering. Like, we're in Australia. We're in a first world nation. Like, this is for the organization. The whole reason for doing, like, we got to make sure we take an offering. And he's like, yeah, I don't think she'll take one. She'll be upset if we take an offering, because it would interrupt what God was doing in the service. And I'm like, and so, you know, me and my natural mindset, you know, I'm like, well, then we'll put buckets in the back. We'll announce that there's buckets in the back, you know, like,
right.
And so, you know, we're like trying to, you know, we're like putting buckets in the back, and, you know, she calls Will over, and he's like, she said to take the buckets away. Just because she doesn't ever want it to be about anything other than Jesus.
No.
And I'm like, but.
And she knows. And she knows, because she's trusted him for her life. So she knows that if she honors his presence and forgets about the buckets, he'll give her so much more another way. It's so beautiful. Gosh, I watched. She's in a really motherly way, as only Mama Hyde can. She was speaking at some friend's church or whatever, and just before she came out, they were doing announcements, and they were like, and you can get this, you know, the books that are in the back. And she walks out and looks at them, and in front of everybody goes, I'm not here to sell books. Like, she was very like, it was like a rebuke. They're like, okay, and we won't do that again. You know what I mean? But they tell the story. Awesome. It's really, oh, she's wonderful. I'm so thankful she exists. Mm. Like, once in a generation. You know what I mean? Like, she's a once in a generation.
She's like the sand in the oyster that makes the pearl, like in the church. I think she's like that. Hey, guys, you got a lot of it right. And here's a little irritation here. Because honestly, you know, at conferences, you know, there's a reason to do it. You know, we do it for Jesus and we do it for growth and community and all these other amazing things. And then there's this, you know, you're trying to help support the ministry. So some of that is in book sales and offerings and you know, and then Heidi comes in and is like, yeah, it's not about that. You know, and you're like,
no,
that's right.
No, and you know, he will sustain it's easy to get off track. But it is.
And Charles, and actually Charles Stock is the same way. You know, he's,
I love,
you know, you meet with
man.
Charles and Anne and you're like, oh, and a lot of the staff here, all the senior mm-hmm. leaders here are mm-hmm. just so amazing and challenges you. And you're like, okay, I got to grow more for sure. But Charles is great. He makes me feel like I'm meeting with the Pope or something. I don't know.
No, but, and that million-dollar smile, man, you just know you could do anything and God's with you.
Yes.
He
cares. I'll be like, Charles, I'm sorry. I disappoint. Be like, oh, Paul, you know, just things happen and you're going to be okay. And, you know,
he's truly fatherly. He really is truly fatherly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, we need more of them, Paul. Lord.
Yes, yes. Lord, well, that's why I love this mother and father's type of raising up. And mm-hmm. in addition to, you know, all the other types of leaders we have, I think mothering and fathering is awesome.
Yeah, I'm like, Lord.
That's what I want on my gravestone.
Same. Like, if I never touch a mic again, Lord, send me, just make me a mama. Help me to walk them home. You know, like, I don't want to, you know, oh, we want to pass it on. We want to pass everything he's given us on. The purity would remain, that it wouldn't be mm-hmm. compromised. Anyways.
It's awesome. Well, Steph, first of all, I appreciate you doing this podcast. I know some of you are going to be blessed by it. But would you be, a lot of our guests pray for our listeners. And even though they're not listening now, we post this.
Of course.
But would you be able to pray for them and just bless them and however the Lord leads you? And then we'll say goodbye.
Yeah, of course.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your presence with us, Lord.
Yes, God.
There is nothing that we treasure more. We've tasted and seen that you alone are good. There's no other reason worth living. You are the water in the well, the hunger and the food. You alone satisfy. We have found our joy in knowing you and being yours, our purpose in being yours. From you and through you and to you are all things.
Let's go.
And we climb up on the altar again and yield our lives to you afresh and anew, because you're worthy and you're absolutely wonderful. And I ask you, Lord, that everyone in the sound of my voice would be wooed by the Holy Spirit, your precious presence here with us. And I ask, Lord, that these stories, these testimonies, some funny, some not, Lord, that the testimony of Jesus is what would be heard. That you alone are the great deliverer, that you take our little and that you make it much. That you take everything we offer to you and do more with it than we could do in a thousand lifetimes. You are wonderful.
And I ask, Father, that you would keep us by your mighty power, that our lives would shout that you alone are God, that Jesus, the precious Lamb who was slain, is worthy, endlessly worthy of all we have and all we own, all will ever be. And I ask, Lord, that desire for you would consume them, that everything else would fade into the background, and that you would truly be everything, that you would be everything. You're the good shepherd, that you would lead them. Lord, I thank you for Paul. Thank you for Ruth. Thank you for the whole New Life House. Father, we ask for a fresh visitation of your presence.
Yes, God.
Lord, I ask that your glory would fall on them, and that it would not lift, and that you would move in a way that is deeper and higher and wider than they have ever known before, that you would expand their capacity to hold what it is you're going to pour out.
Yes, Lord.
And from our house to theirs, we bless them, each one, in the name of Jesus. I ask that they would deepen in communion with you, Father, Son, and Spirit, and deepen in communion with one another, all to the glory of your name. We're alive to know you. We're alive to be with you, to be connected to you. Let this love, this communion, spill out into the world and draw them in. We thank you that there is a seat for each one at the table of the Lord, and that you long that all your children would sit with you again at your table. Thank you, Lord. In your precious, wonderful name, we ask all these things, knowing that it is your desire to give them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Steph, that's so amazing. Thank you so much.
So good to see you, Paul.
So good to see you too. You are like, you got, and not saying you are her, but you have this Catherine Coleman feel about you. Has anyone ever said that to you? Yeah. Yeah. So very similar anointing. I can't wait to watch how God uses you the next 10, 20 years.
Thank
Bless you
for...
and Stephen. We'll be praying
Thank
for you.
You. Oh,
and we can't
here.
Wait for you guys to come out at some point. I know you're so busy, and
I can't.
It's
wait.
So good to be home.
No.
But
yes,
if you ever have
is.
A chance, we'd love to have you.
Oh, I'd love it. Oh, I love that place. I would come anytime I could. Yeah.
Awesome. Awesome. All right, I'm going to put you in the back real quick, and then we'll disconnect. So I hope this blessed you guys. I hope you had an amazing time listening to Steph. I hope it drew you closer to him. I hope it realigned, recentered, refocused you. I hope it brought some repentance to you. You know, I just God was bringing up some things that I just got to take back to the altar and ask for forgiveness for. Just maybe fear of man I put on the seat, enthroned on a place where it shouldn't have been. Bless you guys. See you soon. If you haven't signed up for Firestorm, we're going to start rolling out some promotions for that. Check that out. And we'll talk to you soon. Take care.